very much.
Good evening. Richard, I just wanted to begin by putting this to you. There are a couple of things you don't have in common with us. None of us have made $1 billion this week. and you, unlike virtually everyone here, didn't go to university. Is there something in that, that you are in a sense free of the constraints of a university?
Possibly. Interestingly, in the UK, almost every single successful entrepreneur of my generation left school at 15. Anita Roddick and Alan Sugar and, I mean, you name them, they all left school at 15. And I think that we didn't have decent business, business study, business universities at that time in the UK.
You do now.
But we do now. Mm. I think the danger, I mean, by leaving school at 15, we had nothing to lose.
So I'm just going to bring this down a bit because I think I can hear myself echoing a bit. Can everybody hear me all right?
That's better, actually.
The danger of when you go to university, obviously you learn a lot, but by the time you're 22 or 23 and you leave university, it's possible that you've got a relationship, with a partner. You may have got a mortgage, and you start becoming conservative as you get older. Whereas, at 15, 16, you've got nothing to lose. You're not tied down. If you fall flat on your face, you can just pick yourself up and start again. So I think the key for people who go to university and study is, is by all means absorb all that knowledge and go out with a lot more knowledge than you can at 15. But you've got to be willing to take risks, and you've got to be willing to. If you want to be an entrepreneur, if you want to set up your own business, you've got to still be bold, and you've got to be willing, to put everything on the line on occasions.
Well, let's dive into your past a bit. At age 7 or 8, you say you couldn't read.
I'm mildly dyslexic, so which can be quite amusing. I mean, up until about 3 years ago, I was running Britain's largest group of private companies, and. And I still did not know the difference between net and gross, which is, and so I would be having board meetings, and the sort of just like glazing would go over my mind. I'd say, is that good news or bad news? and somebody would say, well, it's good news, Richard. Anyway, so and then somebody sat me down and tried to explain. Well, the fish that are in the net, that's net. The fish that are outside the net, that's gross. Anyway, so I finally sort of got there. So it doesn't matter too much if you don't know these things. But being dyslexic has meant that, and there are quite a few quite interesting people in the world who are dyslexic. I simplify everything. I write everything on. If I'm working out a business plan, I'll write things down on the back of an envelope and the pros and the cons.
So it does away with all that bureaucracy.
It gets away with bureaucracy, and also, if you move into, say, the financial service industry, instead of, I will try to make sure that I can understand it. So, the word bid offer spread. I mean, why do people tell people that the bid offer spread is 5% when 99% of people won't know what bid offer spread is? In fact, of course, the reason they use the word "bid offer spread" is because they're taking 5% of your money before you even start. I try to simplify everything I do in my approach to the public.
So has that influenced the way you actually style your work? I mean, you're always on the phone. You may as well have one permanently in your ear, it's said. Work from home a lot, not surrounded by layers of bureaucracy. I mean, would you have gone a different way?
I suspect a lot of my decisions is based on gut feeling. I mean, and often bad personal experiences make me go into industries. I mean, I used to have quite a big record company. We had offices all over the world. I was traveling a lot around the world. And the experience on the airlines I was traveling on was absolutely dire. and thoroughly unpleasant. And you could tell that the people who were actually working in those airlines obviously did not enjoy the experience at all. They never smiled. The food was dreadful. There was no films. There was no entertainment. And it was just a dreadful experience. And I just felt, you know, there must be a way of making flying more enjoyable. And, you know, ended up, you know, buying a secondhand 747 to see where to, you know, to give it a go between London and New York. And attempted to create the kind of airline that I'd like to fly. But what I didn't do was get the accountants in to tell me, you know, to give me figures, because
probably just as well.
Well, I would never have started the airline. As long as you know that you can create a concept that is the best in its field, then generally speaking, you can make it work. If it can be the best value, the best quality, you should be able to attract enough people to make it pay. And unless you try it, you know, you're never going to know. And if I had got the accountants in, I would one set of accountants would have told me why not, why it was bad news. The other one might have come up with some figures to show me why it would work. We might as well just have tossed a coin.
As you left school at age 17, your principal at Stowe, is this the same man whose daughter you seduced?
That was another headmaster.
He said, you're either going to end up a millionaire, Branson, or be in jail. And, well, you spent a night in the cells, but mostly the former's worked more. I'm just curious, I mean, your parents, your grandfather was a high court judge, your father a lawyer and magistrate, your mother obviously very driven towards, you talk about her small business ventures and bailed you out at various times. What was it in the family dynamic which explains who you are?
Well, we haven't really had any business people in our family. They're more sort of from the legal background. I think it was, you know, my mother, the female side of our family, are extremely driven. I mean, as a child, I wasn't allowed to watch television. I had to be out.
That's the answer.
I had to be out doing things. We weren't allowed to go and watch people play football. We had to be playing football. I mean, we were brought up very much to be doing things, and the female side of our family never sits still. They're always traveling around the world, you know, taking on challenges. And so I think I got it from them. My grandmother hit a hole in one at golf at 92, so she kept going a long time. And at 99, wrote me a letter saying the last 10 years of her life were the best of her life. So that's nice to hear as well.
You're also, obviously, you felt very cared for within that.
Yeah, I mean, I'm very fortunate in having a family that are very close and very loving, and I hope to do the same for my children. So that gave me a lot of stability. They didn't have any money, or they didn't have very much money, and so I suppose I managed to have the satisfaction, in a sense, of doing it myself and not being given it by them, and actually having just to go out into the jungle and learn the art of survival. If you leave school at 15 or 16, the word survival is the key to running a business for many, many years.
Yes, you thought you might be a journalist. Very sensibly, you gave that away to focus on the business side of things. When you set up that student newspaper, and that was audacious, I mean, you did go out and interview people like John Lennon and so forth. I mean, remarkable, in a sense, given your age, the audacity that requires. And you were tentatively getting going in business with, for example, the Oxford Street Shop, the music store, then the mail order business. I mean, where was the point of transition? Where did you think, actually, I've got much bigger thoughts than that? I mean, maybe what was to unfold over the next few decades? Where did that start?
Well, I was never interested in being a businessman or an entrepreneur. I was interested in running a magazine. I was interested in putting the world right, as you are when you're 15 and you all dream. And I wanted to be, I wanted to be an editor. I soon found, I mean, I didn't have any money, so I had to work out of the school telephone box selling advertising space. And I soon found that in order for to keep the magazine going, I had to learn the art of being an entrepreneur, to deal with the printers, to deal with distribution, to deal with the advertising side. Otherwise, my magazine wasn't going to survive. And ever since then, I haven't ever sort of sat back and thought, how can I make a fortune, or you know, what's the next business venture I can do?
But you do say in that book that fantasizing is sort of one of your preoccupations, which I presume means fantasizing about business, actually. About what's possible.
Well, lots of fantasizing. I love doing is creating. I mean, I love seeing an industry, seeing its soft underbelly, what's wrong with that industry, and seeing whether we can change it, and you know, hopefully sort of take it on and make sure that industry is never the same again as a result of Virgin moving in and taking it on. So in a sense, I see my life as the university education I never had. I mean, I love looking at an industry and seeing whether I can get in there and change it, and get a group of people around me to and learn all about it. And I think, you know, what I have learned is that if you can run one business well, you can really run any business. I remember when we went into the airline business, Lord King, who was chairman of British Airways at the time, said that I was obviously too old to rock and roll, too young to fly, and yet I think what he didn't realise was that yes, we'd been running a record company, but running an airline was not that different. I mean, what a business is all about is people.
But in a sense, you don't really run the businesses either, do you? I mean, you run the ideas, you run the leveraging.
What I do is I spend 3 months running any new business I set up and immersing myself in it, learning as much as I can about it. And then during those 3 months, I've tried to find excellent people to actually run it on a day-to-day basis. But I want to be able to know about that business if they ever phone me. But if you can get the right people who are good at dealing with people, then you've got a chance of making it a success.
I was going to ask you about the stunts/adventures, because they've been great adventures too. Was that and that goes right back to the music store of doing something which was different to capture attention. Was that seen from the very beginning for you as a means of actually getting attention without having to pay for it?
Yes, I mean, when we set up the airline, we set it up soon after Sir Freddie Laker had gone bankrupt and in fact had been driven out of business by British Airways. And I had him to lunch one day, and he said, look, you're never going to have the advertising power of British Airways or Pan Am or TWA in those days. You've got to use yourself. And believe it or not, I was quite shy and retiring at that stage, so using myself wasn't that easy. But over the years, I think I've mastered the art somewhat.
In some respects, that's an interesting point, because in a way you are quite private. There's a side to you which doesn't find this easy, for example. You don't do this often.
Yes, well, I suspect I'm slightly uncomfortable having left school at 15 talking at a university, but anyway. But I think that the thing that I learned from it was if you're going to be chairman of a company, and if you have a high public profile, I can have, pick up the phone to almost anybody in the world, get straight through, and get things done. And if I hadn't had these wonderful adventures, the boating and the ballooning adventures, I wouldn't have necessarily put Virgin on the map globally. They were wonderful personal challenges, but they also helped the company as well.
Just because we might not cover this in the questions from everyone else. What's the business plan for the Virgin Group in Australia next year? Because you're talking about the float of Virgin Mobile. There's Virgin Atlantic is going to come here mid-year. And there's lots of challenges on with Jetstar, obviously, wanting to gun you down.
Well, Australia, there are other industries which we'd like to take on in Australia. The host who
What did he do? He introduced me. Thank you. It's from the banking world, and you know, I think the bank, that there are some aspects of the banking world that are ripe for a slightly more consumeristic approach. So we're looking
beyond
credit cards, yeah. And so we're looking at radio, we're looking at one or two other industries. And I think, I mean, the key thing is that, you know, is we have a great brand, and we have to be out. There's only any reason in extending that brand if the new project we do actually is something which people can say, you know, wow, that's a, you know, that was fantastic. The Virgin did it that way. And therefore, you know, it enhances everything else we do. And so, you know, we won't, you know, just move Virgin into new areas for moving it into new areas' sake, or just to make money. We've got to, you know, it's got to be a real reason for us to take on an industry.
Would Virgin Blue have been in trouble without a float, given Qantas's intentions?
No, I don't think so. I mean, I think Virgin Blue has, you know, been, you know, we've got an exceptional group of people working there. The formula is absolutely right. You know, you've got great quality, great staff, great value for money. You know, the youngest fleet of planes, lowest cost base of almost any airline in the world.
Up against a competitor with a big war chest, though.
Up against a competitor with very high costs, and a competitor that did have a bigger war chest than us up till 2 days ago. I think that Qantas, I think it could have some challenging times ahead. I think there.
The hardheads in business would say, if you look at your investment record, I mean, as an outsider looking to invest in, say, Virgin Blue, that companies like this do well because there's a great deal, as we've seen, a great deal of energy around the launch. But over the longer run, it's not necessarily a good investment. I mean, airlines are a very tough way to make money. And also, I mean, looking at you, you've very sensibly cashed in some of your shares. You've taken $500 million out. So no matter what... No matter what, you've got a pretty handsome dividend. I mean, I suppose that's right, isn't it? That's a fair critique.
Well, I mean, in interviews, I've said to people, which you have to say really, that you know, that investing in shares is risky, and investing in airline shares is even riskier. The track record of really good quality, low cost airlines around the world has been pretty stunning. I mean, Southwest, JetBlue, EasyJet, Ryanair, Virgin Blue down here.
Virgin Express hasn't been a great hit.
Virgin Express, we made the mistake of buying an airline rather than setting up an airline. It was actually beginning to do very well it was doing well enough to our principal competitors, since Sabena went bankrupt. But rather than the local government in Brussels allowing us then to become effectively the flag carrier, the King of Belgium twisted the arms of 100 big Belgian companies and forced them to set up another Sabena Mark II. So effectively both of us, you know, I mean, the marketplace is not really, there's not enough room for both, you know, both airlines. Very nearly, if the Labour government had got elected about 18 months ago, they would have done the same with Ansett. They would have propped Ansett up. The end result would have been much higher airfares for the travelling public. And obviously it wouldn't have been as easy for Virgin Blue if that had happened.
Now, I'm going to open this up right now with one more question in mind. So we've got some roving microphones which can go around. So if you identify yourself, then I can ask you the question. But I'm intrigued. Are you a happy person?
I sometimes think that if I'm not happy, I'll be a bit of a sad case. But no, I mean, I have, you know, every minute of my life is you know, fascinating, and got a great family, and I love people.
I think about the family. There's a lot of stuff about work-life balance. I mean, you must have a terrible work-life balance.
Surprisingly, we have a pretty good balance in that I was quite successful quite young. And I promised my family that when the kids went on holiday, I'd go on holiday with them. So
3 months a year, you know, we pack the bags and go off together. And so, you know, which obviously most parents are unable to do. I must admit that I get up early and, you know, get on the phone for, you know, for the first few hours of those days. But at least I'm around them. I've always worked from home, interestingly. So, you know, originally from a houseboat, and so even although I'm working, the kids have always been, you know, running around, you know, and so. So we are a very close family as a result of that, and it's worked out well.
Do you consider, have you thought about the issue of whether you're happier than the next guy?
Not particularly. I mean, I'm pretty.
You don't look unhappy.
I'm pretty all right.
First question. Who'd like to ask it? And perhaps you'd just. Say who you are as you ask the question. Yes, gentleman down here. So if there's a microphone coming, if you just say who you are. If you're a graduate, say what year you were here, if you would. Others will be interested. They'll think, I must look after that person. Yes.
Hi, my name's Joe, and I'm a student here about to graduate. And I was going to ask you, I'm looking down the road here where I have a couple of business ideas, thinking of starting it up, but I've also got an option to, say, join an investment bank. So first of all, do you think, which of these options do you think I should be going with? And my second part of the question is,
What does my sponsor say?
And second part is, When you think of a business case or a business and whether you should invest in it, how much credit do you give to the investment bankers who are advising you whether you should do it or you shouldn't do it?
Well, having sort of said that most entrepreneurs in Britain leave school at 15, one of the advantages of university is the insurance it gives you. So if you leave university and you have a go at setting up your own business and you fall flat in your face, you would have had an incredible experience, and having got the degree behind you, I suspect, you know, going into an investment bank after that, at least you'll be able to go back to the investment bank and earn a decent living afterwards, and it would be a pretty rotten investment bank that I think took the fact that you'd actually tried to succeed and failed into they should actually give you brownie points for that. So if you've got a good business idea, I would say give it a go. But you've at least got the fallback position. And your second question was?
Second question was in relation to how much credit you give to the investment bankers or the accounting firms and so on, who tell you whether it's a good idea or a bad idea, or is it much of a gut feeling?
In my own case, it's generally speaking. It's from a gut feeling, from personal experience, and that we go into business. Once you've grown a business, then that's the time maybe to go along to merchant banks, you know, for advice on floats or raising money or the like. But they won't even want to know you until you've actually, you know, unless you're wanting to borrow more than, you know, £200,000 or £300,000. I'm afraid, you know, one of the faults of the system. Is there merchant banks are not good at dealing with startup businesses? Venture capitalists, there are venture capitalists that specialise in startup businesses, but there is actually a lack of help given to people with good ideas who want, you know, $10,000, $20,000, $30,000 to start up in business, and I suspect that's a gap in the market that should be filled.
Was your question also about how much notice? Do you pay? How much attention do you pay to the advice you get from investment banks? Is that
obviously, if you respect the merchant banker, you pay a lot of attention. There's a merchant banker here called.
Who do you respect?
What's that?
Who do you respect?
We've been using Goldman Sachs on this float, and they've been absolutely superb. But it's often down to an individual. You know, if you find the right individual. There are good merchant bankers and there are bad merchant bankers, but if you it's everything's down to individuals in the end.
Now, someone else. Yes, and I'll come down to the back in just a moment. So let's go to this lady here, and then I'll come down to the back next.
Hi, my name's Mary DeWeese. I'm from the School of Marketing here at the University of New South Wales. You said you love people, and you talked about handling people, and that's the secret to your success. I think we'd like to know, what is it about the way you handle people that makes you so successful?
Well, I think that you know, first of all, we try to take on people. I mean, the criteria for taking on somebody to run one of our companies is that they're good in dealing with people. If you're running a company, you know, it's very important you don't get stuck behind a desk. It's very important that you get out amongst your people. I mean, if I'm on a plane, you know, I will spend the flight, you know, getting around, meeting all the passengers, but just as importantly, meeting the staff. I'll always have a notebook in my back pocket, and you know, if a staff member has an idea or a problem, you know, we'll always take a note of it. If I'm staying in a city, I will always stay in the city that our staff, you know, in a hotel that our staff are staying at, so that you know, so that in the evenings, you know, I can party with them, socialise with them, get drunk with them, again, as I did last night. Again, always with a notebook and a pen in one's pocket, because you know, if you're getting drunk with them, you're not going to remember what they say to you. So, and then the next morning, you know, we'll make sure that I deal with all the issues that were raised. I mean, I was drinking in the bar on Saturday night, and one of the cabin crew members had forgotten to get her allocation of shares. And the share allocation had closed, and so, you know, Sunday morning managed to make sure that she got her allocation of shares. I mean, it's little, you know, little things, you know, but I mean, like that, that you know, I think make a big difference in a company. And you know, once a month, I write to all our staff, and in companies where I'm chief executive and you know, tell them what's going on. Suggest that they write to me with problems or suggestions and give them my home address, and I get about 60 or 70 letters a day from staff, and make absolutely certain that those letters are the first letters I answer. And that's not only good from the staff's point of view, it's also fantastic from the business point of view, because you know, if a manager somewhere has made a mistake, I will know about it. And I'll be able to, you know, cut through and make sure that it doesn't get out of control, and we don't have an unhappy, you know, an unhappy staff, because I've managed to jump on it. And it's, you know, I mean, if you say take the Virgin Blue staff, we have, you know, one of the happiest staff you can imagine in any company in the world. One bad management decision could blow that. If it's left, you know, there for a sort of 2 or 3 or 4 months to fester. And you know, we just must never ever let that happen. So you know, that sort of communication's really important. You know, if I ring the office, it's very important I know the switchboard operator's name, so you know, I can actually talk to the switchboard operator, not just immediately you know, be asked to be put through. It's making sure that the cleaning lady, the switchboard operators, are treated as importantly as your chief executive or directors of the company. And you know, if you go partying, you know, you don't just stand in the corner, you know, with a suit on, sipping sherry with, you know, the other directors. You get out there amongst the people.
Someone at the back, yes.
I'm Les Balzer. I was a graduate in engineering in '67 and science in '68.
I'm sorry, I can't see where it's with her.
Just stand back.
Okay. Oh, sorry, got you.
I once read that your activities were described as branded venture capital. Now, that may not be perfectly adequate. Perhaps there's a hint of truth in it. If there is, then the venture capital industry has not a very good hit rate. Most things that are supported by venture capital die or are very badly wounded. You seem to have an extraordinarily high hit rate. What do you put that down to?
Well, First of all, getting the right group of people around us. Secondly, we don't buy companies. 99% of our companies we grow organically. So, having planted the acorn, we can keep watering it, and it may turn into a giant oak tree, or we may decide to let that one, that particular company wither. But we always make sure that we. We've never actually let a company go bankrupt. So, we've always made quite sure that, we've kept our reputation intact, so we've never had any major disasters as a result. One of the problems, in a sense, of being a branded venture capital company is you can't let a company go bankrupt. I mean, Virgin's name our reputation is everything we've got, and therefore, if you're a venture capital company, they're all too ready to let companies go bankrupt. Their hit record, their hit rate is maybe 1 or 2 out of 10 companies they start succeed. So I think the advantage that Virgin has is we have a great reputation. If we move into a new area, because people trust us, because people may have had a good experience with our airline, if we launch a credit card, they may try our credit card. If they've had a good experience with the credit card, they then may try our mobile phone company and so on. And we just got to make sure that we keep on delivering. Starting new businesses, just to sort of diverge slightly, it is a perilous thing to do, and most new businesses do fail. So I think anybody embarking on setting up a business has to accept that the chances of success are not great. It's up to society to make sure that people who try and fail don't feel in any way ostracized from doing so. America is very good at that. Most of the big entrepreneurs in America have been bankrupt on a number of occasions. They've learned from that experience. And hopefully, I'm not quite sure how Australia behaved, but hopefully the same applies here.
What about an exit strategy from businesses that are just not performing well? Given that what you said, you can't allow a business to go bankrupt because that will tarnish the image. How do you, and you have exited various things.
Yeah, we haven't exited very many things, if we did exit a business...
Condoms was one, wasn't it?
We're still selling condoms. If we do exit a business, we've got enough resources now to make sure that we would settle any debt. So it's great to be able to say we've never let a company go bankrupt. Having said that, if you're starting off in business and you run into financial trouble, it's a limited company. You shouldn't be worried about letting a company go bankrupt because people who are trading with you know the risk they're taking, and it shouldn't deter you from setting up in business. The fear of bankruptcy shouldn't deter you.
Someone else, yes, and then I'll come to you.
Whilst we're waiting for the question, the condom company that we set it up when AIDS was becoming a major issue about 8 or 9 years ago, and Durex had an absolute monopoly of the condom business in the UK, selling 99% of all condoms sold. Because they were selling 99%, despite the AIDS epidemic, they weren't spending any money on advertising at all. So our healthcare foundation thought that if we could launch a brand of condoms, we could force them to advertise. And we launched a brand called Mates. And about 4 months after launching it, I got a letter of complaint from one of our customers. It's all very well having letters of complaints in a music store or other things, but the condom business is no laughing matter. So I sat down and wrote a letter back as best you could, apologising profusely. A few months later, I got this delightful letter from the same lady with a picture of the baby. asking whether I'd be godfather, And so anyway, I'm now godfather to the beautiful girl called Alice. So all worked out in the end. So.
Yes.
Yeah, I just want to change the topic a bit. my name's David Rybacek, and I'm a graduate, and now I work with a Chinese community group, and I help to connect the East and the West. And, of course, the Chinese people is a huge population, 1.3 billion people. They're very enterprising people, yet still somewhat restricted in their homeland. I was wondering, as one of the most successful people on the planet, if you have any special words or message for the Chinese people.
I think they're learning pretty fast themselves without any advice from me. One of the problems about having talks like this is they can come back and bite you. And I was doing a talk in Greece about 6 years ago, and somebody asked me a question, and he kept on asking, you know, standing up and asking more and more questions. And about 5 years later, he's become one of our biggest competitors in a particular business that we're in. So, and I think the Chinese are going to become phenomenal competitors to all of us over the next 20, 30 years. They're becoming more entrepreneurial and capitalistic than a lot of us. They are great listeners. But there are also obviously enormous opportunities, and I think Australians and entrepreneurs in this room. Who studied China, I'm sure that there will be enormous business opportunities for you in the future.
Have you looked at going in there?
We've got a few things we do in China. We fly to Shanghai, but we haven't set up any major businesses in China yet. I think, but at some stage we will. I was walking down the street this morning, and young man, he was obviously a bit of a fan. He was sort of shaking, came up, and I said, he just couldn't get his words out. And then finally he blurted them out. He said, "I love you." and then he said, "And I wish you were gay." and then he said, "And I wish I was gay." and then he asked for a picture for his wife.
Hi, Sir Richard. David Toza, finance and law, final year student. As a young entrepreneur, I find it really difficult to contract with companies in particular, to find respect from older people who I'm dealing with, especially in meeting milieus. And I also find it very difficult in tender process to win tenders and to obviously contract in that respect. How in your junior days, when you were younger than I am now, and I'm 23, did you contract with people and to prove to them your ability? You had amazing ideas, quite obviously, but how did you get the power and respect from them to win contracts and to raise financing, of which convincing a 40-year-old banker of a super idea is really quite difficult when they're conservative? How did you do this when you're under 20?
I didn't really, I think, is the answer. I mean, I think to get the magazine going, I had to sell £4,000 or $6,000 worth of advertising to cover the printing and the paper costs, and then use that money to print the magazine, and then hopefully sold enough magazines to cover the remaining costs. So getting money from banks was extremely difficult. When I did start borrowing money from banks, when I got to 22, 23, 24, it became very perilous because the one occasion that we went over our overdraft limit was the weekend that we launched the airline, and we had this. We had this experience where some birds went into one of our engines and the engine exploded, and we were $1 million, down on our first day of our new airline. And I came home after the inaugural flight to find the bank manager sitting on my doorstep, he came into my room and told us that he was foreclosing on our record company, our airline, you know, everything and 5,000 employees on the Monday. And I was just shaking, you know. I sort of took him by the arm and pushed him out of my house and told him he wasn't welcome in my house, which is quite a brave, but a foolhardy thing to do to a banker, actually. But, and you know, that weekend we managed to scramble together just about enough money to cover it. And but bankers can be absolutely ruthless, and you know, and so, you know, if you can try to avoid you know, too many loans with bankers, it's not a bad idea.
Special hi to all the bankers here tonight.
I mean, it's. I mean, again, you know, yes. I mean, maybe to give up 25% of your company and try to get some money in that way is maybe safer than just trying to borrow money. You know, borrow monies. But then you might kick yourself later on if it's enormously successful. But you can always start another company without them next time around.
I think I've neglected the back a bit. And I'll come back to you because I saw you earlier. Yes.
Hi, Sir Richard. My name is Adam Maloof. I'm a Commerce Law graduate from New South Wales Uni.
Nice to talk to you.
Thank you, you too. Obviously, when you started Virgin Blue, and even today, you still have a very important corporate and financial relationship with Patrick Corporation and Chris Corrigan. What, in your view, when you started the airline here as part of the strategy to build Virgin Blue going forward, what was the long-term rationale for establishing and subsequently cultivating a relationship with Patrick Corporation?
Well, the way Virgin Group funds itself is, principally, we're a private group of companies, so we have very few public companies, and the way we fund new ventures is to cash in a few chips of companies as we go along. So, you know, we'd seen that the mobile phone business in America was very poorly run. There were very expensive contracts. Very few people had prepaid phones. And, you know, we wanted to launch into that industry before, you know, before somebody else saw the market opening. And, you know, so we decided, you know, we would sell a few shares in Virgin Blue and then move that money into the mobile phone business in the States. And that's very much how, you know, how Virgin expands and moves forward. The other advantage of Patrick Corporation was they had some clout with government, so they were, you know, had a lot of expertise in the transportation business. We had decided to take Virgin Blue public, and Chris has got a lot of expertise in the public market. So we weren't just bringing in a financial partner; we were bringing in somebody who we thought could, you know, bring something to the table apart from just money.
There is someone? Okay, so let's go to this gentleman first.
I met another entrepreneur just while we were waiting on the streets in London a couple of weeks ago. She was about 11 years old, and I was walking past her school, and she saw me, and she said, do you know something? She said, you look just like that Richard Branson bloke. She said, you know, you might not make as much money as him, but have you ever heard of lookalike agencies?
Yes.
My name is Dave, and I teach people management here at the university. My question
do you
for
teach
you,
what? Sorry.
People management.
Okay.
So I'm quite chuffed at your opinions on people. Your brands have a particular cachet with the young age segment. A lot of youth and vitality, but the fastest growing age segment in Australia is the over 55s. They tend to be very, very value conscious, and you obviously have some very value driven products. Are you particularly looking at that nexus for marketing opportunities?
Well, as I said earlier, we normally go into businesses that we have some you know, personal experiences in, and as I get older, I'm sure we'll start to look at them. You know, you'll have, Virgin Pensions, but I suppose ultimately Virgin Funeral Homes. So all ideas welcome anyway. But I'm going to leave it at just a few more years.
And the final question up the back. Yep.
Sir Richard John McCarroll, how did you choose the name Virgin?
Well, I was 15 years old. And I was inexperienced, and I was also inexperienced at business. So, the alternative, I mean, we got down to two names. It was either going to be Slip Disc Records or Virgin. And somehow Slip Disc Condoms or Slip Disc Airlines, I don't think, would have been successful. So I think we were fortunate in the choice of name. And a brand name actually is a name of a company is quite important. You know, if you can get the name right. I mean, the great thing with Virgin is almost any new business we think about doing, it works. I mean, you know, health foods, Virgin Foods would be pretty good. I mean, you know, it's just almost anything you think of. So we've been very fortunate with the brand. And if you want to come up with a brand and you're thinking big and thinking internationally, try to think of a name that works, you know, as well in China as it does in Australia. And I think if you're just going to set up a new business, you want to try to make sure that any business you do can be taken globally. And not just think locally.
Back in those days, the thought was we're all virgins of business, wasn't it?
Were very much all virgins of business at the time.
Now, I shook Richard's hand earlier, so I'm selling the DNA later if anyone thinks that's going to help. Richard, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Thank you.